been a Canadian citizen for over a decade, but I'm not a Canadian enough to know who that old dude is on the screen and why you all like him. Like, that never made it across the Atlantic Ocean for reasons known only to somebody else. This summer we've been thinking and looking at the fruit of the Spirit, the words that Paul records in Galatians chapter 5 when he says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And he reminds us against those things, there's no law whatsoever. We've been trying to figure out and ask ourselves, how do we have more of these attributes in our life? More love, more joy, more peace, more patience. I just make out standing in the long line at Superstore this week. Did it work? I got a confession to make. It was never a good thing. I was in Co-op on Friday just picking up three things. That's all I had to get. I had the three things and I got to the checkout line. There's only one counter open and there's like a gazillion people there. This is where I'm a complete hypocrite because I went to the self-checkout scan, got my three things and left faster than anybody else in the building. I know the Holy Spirit's got a lot to do if he's going to teach me how to be patient. But I heard some of your funny stories too. But today we come to kindness, more kindness. Kindness is kind of cool today. There's a kindness campaign online that you can be part of. You can order t-shirts from them. McLean's really recently had an issue devoted completely to the topic. You can go to Indigo and buy some best-selling books on the subject. What's it actually all about? I read this story this week, really made me smile. It's a guy, he's stranded at the side of the road, his car's died, it's not working, there's no electrical charge. And a very kind librarian pulls up beside him and sees him struggling and she decides she's going to help. She gets out, they have a conversation together about what could happen. And he's telling her that if she could just push his car for him, he could jolt it into gear and kickstart it and get it going. Now, obviously, she didn't think she could do that physically, just standing behind him and pushing while he's steering. But the idea was that she would use her car to push his car, get it up to about 30, he suggested to her, and then it'll be okay. This will work. We'll get it happening. She was convinced. He got in his car. She got in her car, and then something happened. She backed up. She backed up some more. She backed up even further, and then she gunned it, aiming for him. The poor guy flew out of the door of his car, dives onto the grass at the side. She just narrowly avoided hitting him and destroying everything. She said to the reporter that was taking note of the story afterwards, "He never told me I should press my bumper against his and then just start that way." Well, it's kind of funny. Kind of, I suppose. Here's the one sad twist to this story. I don't think hardly any of us would have stopped at the side of the road. We wouldn't have done that to help a stranger. Our fear of being robbed or something worse happening, that would make sure that we drove past with our windows up and our locks down. Because fear has pushed kindness into the back seat of our society. It's pushed kindness away. So what exactly is kindness? Is it simply just stopping on the highway to help somebody? Is it being helpful? Does it just mean being nice? What does it mean? It almost can feel like a bit of a vacuous word. We're not sure what we're actually talking about. I've been reading a book that somebody lent me by a guy called Daniel Goldman. It's a fascinating book called The Power of Kindness. He's a physician. He's been a very eminent physician, highly regarded in his field, and his colleagues and patients would all attest to that. But they also thought he didn't have much of a bedside manner. He wasn't particularly kind to anybody, even if he could make you healthy and whole again. And so he began to research this and figure out what he was trying to figure out is what's wrong with me, but then what did kindness mean? He began his book explaining the origin of the word kind. Kind comes from the same root as an old English word, kin, that we sometimes use for family, people that are in our immediate family or even our extended family. It comes from the same sort of phrase when we say two people are two of a kind. They could be siblings, they could be good friends, but they're very close. It refers to the similarity. Kindness implies that there's some sort of connection between me and you, that I recognize that you're somewhat the same as me. It implies kinship. It implies that we're motivated by a desire to cooperate with each other and to help one another, to be generous and thoughtful. In other words, when I'm kind to people, I see them as being like me and me like them. Imagine if we saw people like family. I mean, you'd stop if you saw your kid or your parent or your sibling at the side of the road stuck. You'd pull over and do something to help. You'd put yourself out to do the right thing. So is it really possible for us to see others like that? Could we see other people as family? Could we treat them the same way we would treat our own family? Isn't this what the Bible means when it says that we're all made in the image of God? We're all made in God's image. Something remarkable is going on in the life of every human being. It's why we often say here at FAC, we celebrate each person as invaluable and irreplaceable in the eyes of God, like Jesus. We love people when they least expect it and least deserve it. But honestly, that's not how I always treat people. If you're probably like me, it's maybe not how you treat people either. How we treat colleagues or customers or neighbors or people we don't even know, we don't see them as family. We see them as different. We see them as distant. And when somebody wrongs us or does something to hurt us, we respond immediately with this little phrase that goes through our minds: don't get mad, get even. It's often how we choose to live. Somebody cuts us off on the highway, you pass them so that you can cut them off next. Somebody insults you, you insult them right back. Somebody spreads a rumor about you, you've got a better story about them. A politician says something we don't like, we trash them on social media. When a customer goes to another company, we're thinking, how can we undercut them? When a spouse doesn't make you happy, we feel morally responsible to make them unhappy. Am I right? We see it in all sorts of things. In our own province, our own city, people phoning 911 to complain that an Amber Alert disturbed their peaceful repose. Political discourse that isn't about policies, just trash talking. Even in my lifetime, watching and observing genocides that happened in the Balkans or in Central Africa. And now we have kids imprisoned in cages. At its core, we distance ourselves from others. They're not like me. They're not my responsibility. They are not my family. We've developed this me-first culture that is narcissistic. So how on earth does being kind fit in? There are lots of references in Scripture to being kind. I want to share just one with you this morning. When Paul writes to his friends, the Ephesians, a little church in Ephesus, chapter 4, beginning at verse 31, he gives them these instructions. He says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ forgave you. Love, joy, peace, even patience to some extent. They're inner attitudes. They happen on the inside, and somewhere along the journey, as the Holy Spirit grows his fruit within us, they burst forth. Other people can see these things in our lives as we learn to keep in step with the Spirit. Lots of us have been sharing stories with each other about the ways God's been growing fruit in our lives, because when we make space in our heart, space in our mind, space in our daily living for the Holy Spirit to work, he will grow this fruit within us. Change will happen. People will notice. You will notice. But there's something that distinguishes kindness from love and joy and peace. Those things are attitudes that happen on the inside. But kindness is not internal. It's external. It's an outward action. It's something we do. It's essentially love in action. It requires something to be done. It means that we put love into practice, quite simply because we have the love of God in our hearts. It's what we do that becomes the evidence of faith that has changed our lives totally. It's faith made visible. Try an example. You want a promotion in your company, you've applied for it, you're in with a good chance, it's narrowed down to two people, and the other person begins to tell a few stories about you that aren't quite accurate. And it costs you the promotion. You don't get it because of what that person said. Clearly wasn't kind, but what are you going to do? You've been wronged. What would you do as a follower of Jesus? The Bible's telling us, don't get even, be kind. Help the other person succeed in the position that you wanted. I mean, that's crazy. Actually, do the best you can to make that person successful. How does that work out? It's Christian. It's countercultural. It's making the other person successful, making them a winner. It's actually being kind. Now, that's not easy. I don't think that comes natural to hardly any of us. It's why it's the fruit of the Spirit. God's got to be working in our lives, working in our hearts if we're going to live that way. He has to change my heart if I'm going to live that way. This is not about me trying hard. This is about me relying on God to work in my life, a choice that any of us can make today. Is it risky? Yes, it's risky. People will take advantage of you. You'll be seen as a spineless wimp. People will think that your kindness is in agreement with their choices or behaviors. You'll lose customers. You'll lose reputation. You'll lose promotion. You'll feel misunderstood. There are all sorts of risks in choosing to follow Jesus down this path. Is it hard? I think so. Going with the crowd is easy. Getting even with somebody might make you feel better for a while. But living like Jesus wasn't easy for Jesus. And I don't think living like Jesus would be easy for us either. Is it worth it? Absolutely. It's this kindness that became a distinguishing feature of those very first Christians in the Roman Empire, where in their church gathering and in their expression outside of church, their kindness was life-changing. They didn't try to prove they were right. They didn't try to get even. They were simply kind to each other. They lived to a different standard. And when the imperial government tried to crush them and persecute them, it didn't work because they were kind to their persecutors. They were kind to their torturers. They were kind to their executioners. To the point those people couldn't stand it anymore. Those Roman soldiers turned to Christ in their thousands. Maybe the place we could start is with our church family. But hey, then, what if the youth group marginalizes my daughter? What if the people in church kind of promote some politics that I don't really like? What if the services are not what I want? I don't like the music. The service is too long. It's too short. The music's too loud. It's too quiet. Everything's too something. What will I do then? Can I be kind? And not get even and don't quit? See, here's the thing. If we can't actually be kind to each other, how on earth are you going to be kind to somebody you don't know in Jesus' name? How does that work? Tell me. I think this is where we begin in kindness. Kindness could come in our saying kind words to somebody. You did really well with that cake. You baked less, that I still want some of that rhubarb thing you were doing, but there you go. You could be kind by doing things, doing kind deeds. As you're waiting in that enormous checkout line at Superstore, you could offer to pay for somebody's groceries. Whoa. Our kindness could be in our way of being, paying attention, being with somebody when they're hurting or sick, just spending the time with them. Our kindness could be going, giving our time to be with somebody who needs a companion, who's lonely, who needs a friend. But I think there's something very specific that we need to get hold of kindness here. It is love in practice. It's doing love in deeds. It's treating people as our own family. It means you'd put your time into it. You'd put your money into it, your resources and your skills. You'd give of yourself. That's what kindness is. It is essentially treating other people as precious. Kindness and being kind is a kind of valuing. I think one of the most recent stunning, exemplary examples of this has been the Prime Minister of New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern. Her response to the horrific massacres in Christchurch. It's been exemplary in her words as she addressed the minority community, saying, "We feel grief, we feel injustice, we feel anger, and we share that with you," in her words. And also in her actions, offering financial assistance to every family who was hurt or damaged by what happened, passing legislation that would restrict the availability of semi-automatic weapons in her country. She chose kindness over fear. She treated people as precious. Most of us would spend a fair amount of money in our home, whether we're renting or owning, and certainly if we're owning, when things break, we fix them. When renos are due, we save up and make it happening. In the big scheme of things, we realize, while expensive, spending a couple of $1,000s in something that needs fixed at home makes sense. It's valuable to us. It's our most expensive asset. On the other hand, I'm not so sure what you would do if your blender broke. Your blender broke, you asked somebody to fix it, and they said they could do it for $1,000. You're not going to do that. Nobody would spend that much money in a blender. You'll just go back to Walmart and get a new one on the cheap. It's not worth as much. And when Scripture talks to us about kindness, it's talking about an attitude that sees human beings as so infinitely valuable and precious. There's nothing that you could not do for someone. There is no price that is too high. You'd put your money, you'd put your time, you'd put your skills, you'd put your whole self into that relationship. I want you to look at these words on the screen with me from Isaiah chapter 58. When God uses the prophet to challenge his people that are his family, he says, "Is this not the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see them naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood." The prophet is speaking here, comparing the religious activities of God's people, like fasting, with caring for the poor. I could imagine if he was here with us today, he'd say, "You go to church, you give of your money, you fast and you pray and you read your Bible, but the fast that I'm choosing is that you would bring oppression to an end, that you would bring the hungry into your home and care for them. Because people are precious to God. People like you are precious to God. The people you like are precious to God. The people you don't like are precious to God." That's why Jesus taught us not only to love our neighbors as ourselves, he taught us to love our enemies and to do good to those who persecute us. Jesus really digs into this in a story that he tells in Matthew chapter 25. You may remember it. They're talking about at the end of time and what's going to happen to people and where it all goes. And he calls some sheep and he calls some goats, and there's this separation thing that goes on. And at the end of time, God is looking at people, and Jesus is speaking to them as well. And he says, "You can come into my kingdom." And do you know why? He says, "Because I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was shivering cold naked and you gave me clothes. I had nowhere to stay and you invited me in. I was sick or in prison and you came to visit me there." And those people are going, "Seriously? I don't remember ever doing that for you, Jesus. When did that happen?" And he says, "Because you treated these little ones like that, you did it for me." And then he says to some other people, "But look out. You didn't give me anything to eat when I was hungry. Nobody offered me a drink when I was dying of thirst. Nobody gave me a shirt when I was cold. Nobody invited me into the home. Nobody came to visit me or take care of me." And they're like, "Whoa, Jesus, come on. If I'd seen you like that, I'd have done something about it. I never once noticed you in this condition." And he says, "Because you turned your back on those round about you, you turned your back on me." I think this is one of the most unnerving passages in all of Scripture. I mean, have you ever really tried to come to grips with it? Everywhere else in the Bible, we read about God's grace and God's love and God's forgiveness. We realize that God reaches out to us and rescues us because he's a loving God and a kind God. And he reaches out to us in Jesus if we simply receive Jesus by faith, grace and faith together. We're not saved by our deeds or the things that we do. It makes it really clear in the Bible. We're not saved by good works. There's nowhere in the Bible that says social workers get to heaven first. But if we're saved by God's grace through faith in Jesus, then what is the story that Jesus tells all about? I'm pretty certain the only real answer is that being nice isn't what saves us. But our kindness is a demonstration of whether our faith is real. Is it real faith, or do we just pay lip service to Jesus? Have our lives actually been changed, or are we just putting on a show? I think this is put really clearly by Jesus' little brother James when he says this: "Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes or daily food. And if one of you says to them, 'Yo, go in peace, keep warm, be well fed,' but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, it's dead. The fruit of the Spirit is kindness. It is love and action. If the fruit of the Spirit is growing in your life, you will become more kind. God will do that in you. You'll discover that you're willing to sacrifice. You're willing to give. You're willing to burden yourself with the needs of other people. You'll discover God is actually changing your heart. People that don't have what you have, you'll learn to be kind. Kindness happens. was way back, what, 17, over 1700 years ago? The year was 252 AD. A devastating plague hit Carthage in North Africa, a coastal town right in North Africa there. A lot of Christians were there. It was a good, strong Christian community, but they were persecuted and in trouble. And when the plague came through, everybody was leaving town as quick as possible. They were deserting the place to move out and find their own safety. Their pastor at the time, the bishop of their town, was a man called Cyprian. And he gathered all of the followers of Jesus together in the main square of the town and essentially said this to them: if we're going to do what Jesus did, so that through his poverty we might become rich, I'm calling on you to care for those who are sick, to give financially to those who need, to give help to others, to give comfort to people according to their need, not what religion they follow. And it was this countercultural attitude that differentiated these early followers of Jesus from the wider imperial society and contributed to the growth of their faith 100 years later. There's a new emperor. His name is Julian. He's been trying to persecute Christians out of existence, pushing hard against them, and it's not working. He keeps losing. They keep growing. The message of Jesus expands. Jesus becomes famous. Faith goes to new places. And he writes to one of his friends, the emperor, and he says this: nothing has contributed to the progress of the superstition of these Christians as their charity to strangers. The impious Galileans, what a great nickname, because Jesus was from Galilee, the impious Galileans. We should wear t-shirts with that on it. They provide not only for their own poor, but for ours as well. Treating people who are different to you as family. You know what I'm learning? I'm learning that I'm not really being kind. Maybe none of us are. You're not being kind until something changes in my life. So my options are fewer because I'm helping. My resources are diminished because I'm giving. My time is not as frequent for me anymore because I'm involved in somebody else's life. Frankly, if our kindness is not biting at us, I don't think we're helping people enough. The Bible doesn't give us some nice abstract way to try and measure when we've been kind enough. Some of us virtually live in somebody's sofa and have got nothing to offer anybody. We're broke. Some of us are doing very well with lots of resources, but the Bible doesn't sort of give the bare minimum kindness line to us. Oh, I know you can read about giving to God's work and the tithe in Scripture, 10% of our earnings belongs to God, I know that. But it treats it as a kind of a basic rule, a basic bottom line kind of a thing. But till the burden really falls on us, till it really eats at our life and we have less money, we have less time, we have less space, I have fewer choices, I'm not sure we really understand what being kind truly means. But why? Why would it matter? Why would it matter that I would allow God to change my life that much, that it would change everything about how I live? Well, there's some words in Scripture that I'd like you to take a note of. If you want to write them down quickly, you can, if you've got a pen or piece of paper, or use their phone. I think they've already been posted today on social media for you. Let's look at these words of Jesus in Luke chapter 6, verse 35 and 36. Luke 6, 35 to 36. Jesus says, love your enemies. Do good to them. And lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father in heaven is merciful. God is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. That's me. God has been kind to me. Paul writes these words in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. Ephesians 2, 4 through 7. Because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It's by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages He might show us the incomparable riches of His grace, expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. God expressed His kindness more fully in Jesus, who came and offered His life for us as a sacrifice for us and our lives, our sin. Paul writes to his young pastor friend, Titus, Titus chapter 3, verses 4 through 7. He says this: when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, He saved us, not because of the righteous things we have done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, who he has poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. It's not like I deserved anything or you deserved anything. We didn't. It's because of God's kindness and mercy that we are forgiven and made new and welcomed into God's family. All of us, that could be your story today. One more. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Paul writes, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. That's why it matters. It reflects the heart of God. It tells of how God has treated me, how God has treated you. This fruit of kindness, it has a root. The fruit of kindness has its root in the character of God, who out of his kindness has rescued us, forgiven us, made us brand new, brought us into his family, chosen us uniquely for things that he has set apart for us to do in his grand plan to change everything and make his entire universe new again. That's why. It matters that we reflect the heart of God. It matters that people see Jesus in our lives. It's why he made us. It's why he called us into his family. It is God's purpose for your life. It matters. So how would we go about it? How would we go about allowing the Holy Spirit to grow this in our lives? Well, if we understand what kindness is, treating people like family, love in action, seeing other people as precious, and we understand why it matters because it reflects the heart of God, it makes Jesus visible to other people, then we need to figure out how to make space in our lives for the Holy Spirit to go to work and grow this fruit within us. Here's some simple ideas that might nurture some space for you, for God to work in you. Give a smile. But the truth is, we know it, a simple smile can lift anybody's spirits. A neighbor, a co-worker, the person standing you in front of that long line in Superstore while you're all working on patients together. A genuinely warm smile impacts people. Do a chore or run an errand. You vacuum something up, dust something up, cut somebody's grass, go to the store for somebody, take an elderly neighbor or relative in their visit to the doctor, offer to babysit for somebody. There's a bunch of ways that you could step up and spend time in a useful way. You could send a thoughtful note or a text or an email today. You just grab a phone and send it to somebody. Tell them how much you appreciate them. You don't need to wait to their birthday. Just tell them how they mean to you, the impact they've had on your lives. It's such a simple thing to do, and who knows? Maybe the day that they receive it, the moment they received it, they've been feeling down or hurt or lonely, wondering if anybody sees me, does anybody care? And your note arrives just in time. Maybe you could donate food. We do a lot of that round here, gathering food for the food bank. But you don't need to wait till we've got the collection points going again. You could go to any store, buy some canned goods or non-perishable goods and drop them off at their collection for the food bank. It's an easy thing to do. Maybe you could teach somebody a new skill. Lots of us are good at something. Maybe you could show somebody how to change oil in their car. Maybe you're a seamstress or you're a carpenter and you could teach somebody some basic skills. Maybe you're a great cook and you could help somebody with that. There's lots of ways we could come alongside another person. We could redirect gifts instead of getting more things that half the time we don't really need. We could encourage people to give something to charity on my behalf. Help someone else in need, make everybody smile in the journey. You could offer to be a caregiver. Maybe you know somebody that could do with some respite. They're looking after an elderly relative, or maybe they've got somebody with physical or mental disability in their household that they care for. Maybe they've just got little kids and they never get out because they don't have a babysitter. You could come alongside and give somebody a break for a few hours, make a big difference in somebody's life. They're little suggestions. You could think of your own. You don't need me to do that. But I'll make you a promise. I'll make you a promise if you choose to live this way. You'll be wronged. You'll be hurt. You'll be taken advantage of. You'll be manipulated. You'll be abused. You will. You'll be misunderstood. It's guaranteed. So what are you going to do? Will you be kind? Mother Teresa of Calcutta once said this. She said, spread love everywhere you go. First of all, in your own house. Give love to your children or your wife or your husband, to your next door neighbor. Let no one ever come to you without leaving better and happier. Be the living expression of God's kindness. Kindness in your face. Kindness in your eyes. Kindness in your smile. Kindness in your warm greeting. And that will help you grow up in love for one another. And so, Father, today, we pray that you would help us to be kind. It's easy for us to be nice to people we love and care for. It's a different story with those on the margins of our own life. And so we pray today that you would grow the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, that you would grow kindness within us. We recognize this is nigh on impossible in our own, but with you all things are possible. And so we pray, Holy Spirit, blow through this room, blow through our lives until your fruit blossoms within us. Others begin to notice, we begin to notice, and people see Jesus in our hearts and in our lifestyle. We pray for his glory, that his name would be lifted high. We pray today. Amen.